Now we'll talk about routing algorithms. As we are discussing about network layer, so routing is the main function provided by network layer, as all of we know. So one by one we will go through the basic routing methods or the algorithms, the fundamental techniques. First one is shortest path algorithm, second one is distance vector routing algorithm, and third one is link state algorithm. So all these three one by one we will go through. Before starting the discussion of shortest algorithm, we will brief out about the optimality principle, which is key behind shortest path algorithm. Also, we will talk on what exactly are the metrics, like whether it is a delay, cost, distance, or any other thing, number of nodes. So what exactly is a parameter or a metric which we have to take into account. Then the third thing is, there are two possibilities, that is, routing may be done statically or dynamically. So what are the probabilities, and while doing that, whether we are going for the adaptive or non-adaptive way of routing. So these are some of the fundamental issues which are taken into account. So one by one we will go through them, and then we will discuss all the three fundamental methods of routing. As we know that main function of network layer is providing proper method or proper way or guide for the packets, how to get an optimized path, how to travel, and which particular route is to be preferred. So the main function is nothing but the source machine to destination machine, how exactly the packet is to be routed. The algorithm that choose the router routes or the data structures that they use are major area of network layer design. The routing algorithm is part of the network layer software responsible for deciding which output line in incoming packet should be transmitted on. Now there are two processes inside router, that is basically forwarding. One of them handles each packet as it arrives, looking up the outgoing line to the use for it in routing table. This process is simple forwarding. That is, whoever is the adjacent node, on all those nodes, every packet is as it is forwarded. It is called as packet forwarding. The other process is responsible for filling in and updating the routing tables. That is whether the routing algorithm comes into play. Here exactly where we have to decide how to exactly proceed further. So not each and every adjacent node, but you have to decide based on some particular policy, and then the packets are routed. Regardless of whether routes are chosen independently for each packet or only when new connections are established, certain properties are to be taken into account. So they are most wanted features or desirable facts, that is correctness and simplicity, robustness and stability, and fairness and optimality. By default, as we know that everywhere, whatever we implement, we expect that should be simple one, not much complex, because the route estimation itself is going to become very complex. It will be difficult. It will be time consuming. It will add the or increase the system complexity and time complexity issues. So that we don't want. By default, correctness is the very important thing, because based on that only the decision will be taken and a particular packet will reach to the destination. So correctness is inherently the most feature. Robustness, the routing algorithm should be able to cope with changes in the topology and traffic without requiring all jobs in all hosts to be aborted and the network to be rebooted every time some router crashes. So this is one thing where in real time applications we face, because many a times some of the nodes may suffer from some issues, some of the paths may get congested, somewhere there may be very heavy traffic. There must be some ways or some in advance policies which will we can follow, and the router will take the decision based on that. Whatever algorithm is implemented or whatever algorithm is used in the particular network, so every time if some small changes are going to occur in terms of the geometry of the network, that is a topology, or in terms of the number of nodes, or in terms of the some sort of mechanism, so every time everything is to be removed and again newly everything is to be once again implemented, this should not be done. So that robustness, flexibility is expected. Then there is a stability, is also very important, because it should be the performance must be stable. It should not change every time if traffic is changing, every time number of nodes are changing, the results are getting different. So this is not expected. It is a stable performance, not static, but it is a stable. It is dynamic one, but should be a stable one. Fairness and optimality may sound obvious. Surely no reasonable person would oppose them, but as it turns out, they are often contradictory goals, because wherever we say that something we want in a very fair manner, so not necessarily it will be optimal, or like we are looking for some sort of a maximum throughput, maximum efficiency, maximum output, and at the same time we want some sort of fairness in that, because that fairness is impartial, unbiased kind of strategies, and there some decision making, or it will be little bit static then. So whenever we talk about the dynamic performance and all, so somewhere we have to think about, and somewhere there is a trade-off, that is we have to optimize for some particular metric. That is, if we want better result in terms of delay, then somewhere we have to look after the cost. Somewhere we have to compromise for that. When we think about, that is a simple thing. If we want to reach somewhere at the earliest, then if we go by road, and if we go by train, or if we go by air, then which one is going to give you the fastest outcome, that you will have to prefer. And at that time, you have to compromise for the expenditure or the cost. The simple thing. When you want to reach somewhere via some particular location, that is one particular station, if you want compulsorily, then whichever route you have to follow, you have to follow that. So at that time, if delay is to be compromised for, or if cost is to be bear, then you have to take into account that. So whether it is a hop, whether it is a cost, whether it is a delay, or whether it is a distance. So whatever it is, if you want to get some fair outcome, every time, each and everyone cannot be achieved. Somewhere you have to compromise, and that is nothing but the optimality. So general thing, routing algorithms can be grouped into two major classes, that is non-adaptive and adaptive. So in case of non-adaptive, do not base their routing decisions on the measurements or estimates of the current traffic and topology. Somewhere there's a static one time. So instead, the choice of the route to use to get from I to J is computed in advance offline and downloaded to the routers. When the network is booted, this procedure is sometimes called static routing. That is, one time it is done and it is programmed and it is going to follow that, irrespective of what exactly is happening on the route or what exactly meantime might have happened. So you are not going to worry for that. In case of adaptive, in contrast, all the changes, continuous monitoring is done. The decisions to reflect changes in the topology and usually the traffic as well. Adaptive algorithm differ in where they get their information locally from adjacent routers or from all other routers. When they change the routes every time after some particular period or whatever, then whatever metric it is used for optimization, the distance or number of hops or estimated transit time, we already mentioned. So accordingly, it is going to update and change it. So this is called a dynamic routing. Now the optimality principle states that one can make a general statement about optimal routes without regard to network topology or traffic. This statement is known as the optimality principle. It states that if router J is on the optimal path from router I to router K, then the optimal path from J to K also falls along the same route. Okay, this is very clear. Like say for example, we want to go from one place A to one place D, and while going from A to D, if in between there is say for example C, then if from C to D you have calculated something and that is the optimal one, and if you want to go from A to D, then by default, once you go from A to C, and if you want to go to D, then if C to D is the optimal one, definitely that is the same path for each and every station or each and every node, whichever is lying between C to D, like that. Say from A to any other location if you want to go, so whatever is for that, the same thing will be for all which are lying on the same route. Like it is from Pune to Mumbai via so and so, then the same thing is from that location to Mumbai. It is applicable. There is no other alternative. So like that. So this is optimality principle. Shortest path routing is the method It is a algorithm which had been invented in 1950s, like 50s to 60, nearby 56 to 59. In those years, the work was carried out. And this was basically for a traveling salesman person problem based concept or a theory. In the fundamental algorithm theory, it was proposed. Dijkstra's algorithm, it is known, very well known algorithm. Then the idea is to build a graph of the subnet in with each node of the graph representing a router and each arc of the graph representing a communication line or link. To choose a route between given pair of routers, the algorithm just finds the shortest path between the between on the graph. So here we will have some small illustration. Now you can see the network from A, B, C, D, E, F, G and H. The figure A, first figure. Now say for example, what exactly shortest path estimation is all about, we will comment on that. So suppose we want to go from A to D. So in the beginning, what we have to assume is the adjacent nodes which are directly connected to the respective source. Say at present, for our example, source is A. Now A is directly connected to B and G. You can see in figure A. Then B and G is these are the two nodes which are at known distance because they are directly connected. The assumption is the nodes which are adjacent nodes, the nodes which are directly connected, they are at known distance, neighbors, and rest of all are as if assumed to be at infinity distance. And here that infinity is nothing but unknown distance, say for example, and there we are not putting any number. Like say, see here just on the figure. So in the first figure, all the distances are mentioned. That is, A is at a distance 2, B is from C at 7, C is from D at 3, and so on. So like that. Now, in figure B, first step, what we are going to do is, first of all, from source node, our source node is say A, we are going to label on the adjacent neighbors. That is B, in the circular bracket we have mentioned that 2, A, indicating that how far it is from and from whom. So first number 2 is indicating how far, and comma the name is indicating the name of the that particular node, that is A. On the same line, on the G node, we have mentioned G 6, A, that is G is 6 units apart from A, indicating. Now out of these two, which is smaller one? That is 2 and 6, smaller one is 2. So first of all, our aim is to reach from A to D, but out of B and G adjacent node, which one is smaller one, smaller distance? B. So we will go for B, and the method is the graphical method. What we are doing is tentatively we are putting B as a permanent label. That is, we are making that circle, we are filling that, and it is made as a solid fill kind of a node. So B is now A to B is our accepted say path in the first step. At present, rest of all are the circles which are putting which are they're shown on the with along with the node name, they are empty circles, and only B is made a solid circle. Okay, now figure C is a C. Now from B we will check C and E and A. These are the three adjacent nodes. Already we have reached to B from A, so there is no issue. Now from B there are two chances, that is, one is C and another one is E. Now from B to C, distance is 9, already labeled on the graph. That is, distance is 7, but already we have traveled from A to B 2. So 2 plus, it is a cumulative one, it is an inclusive addition kind of a thing. A to B we have taken 2, and again from B to C it will take 7. So 7 plus 2, total it will become 9. So on C we have mentioned there in figure C, just you see at C node we have written there 9, B. That is, we have arrived via B, and the total distance traveled is 9. And on the B node, E node, we have written 4, B. That is, at E we have reached via B. Already from A to B it has taken 2, and B to E in figure A you see there is already 2 distance. So 2 plus 2, total it has become 4. Now if we compare from B node, then C is at 9 and E is at 4. So out of 9 and 4, 4 is smaller one. So in the figure D you can see we have labeled A to B to E. Now we have labeled E solid fill, so E, and we are not going to travel via C now. So at E, if we see the adjacent nodes are, one is B from where we have arrived, and the rest of the two are G and F. So f is at again e to f distance. Figure A you refer once again. E to f distance is 2. B to E we have reached with 4. So 4 plus 2. So at F I will write 6 comma E, and at G, which is adjacent node of E, we will write already from B to E we have reached with 4. E to G is only 1. Figure 1. Once again A figure you refer, E to G. What is mentioned? Distance 1. So 1 plus 4. So total at G it is becoming 5 comma E. So if you see figure D, then G is now labeled as 5 comma E, E is labeled as 4 comma B, F is labeled as 6 comma E. Now F and G, these two are to be compared. F is with 6 comma E and G is with 5 comma E. So out of these two, definitely G is smaller one because 5 is smaller than 6. So therefore now move to figure C, figure E. So here you see that A, B, E, and now we have labeled G. Now G is 5 comma E, that is the smallest one, and F is 6 comma E. Now from G, if we check, we want to go to D. G, their adjacent nodes are, one is A, another one is E, and the third one is H. Already from A to B to E to G we have reached. So there is no question that from G we will go back. Now there is only chance that from G we will have to go to H. G to H, the distance is 4. So on H in figure E you see the label is 9 comma G, that is total distance is becoming when you reach up to H, that is 9. How it is? From A to B to E to G to H, total is becoming A to B 2 plus B to E 2, 2 plus 2 4, E to G 1, 4 plus 1 5, and G to H 4. So that particular plus 4, 5 plus 4, total becoming 9. And the alternative way also here we will estimate E to F. E to F is 6 and F to H is only 2. So F to H is 6 plus 2, that is 8. So if we see, then via G if we come, then it is becoming 9 comma G, and via F if we come, then it is becoming 8 comma F. So we have to look for, whenever there are two options, adjacent nodes, from F the alternative is via E to F to H, or from H if we look back, then via G if you are coming, it is becoming 9 comma G. So out of 9 comma G and 8 comma F, 8 comma F is smaller one. So therefore the algorithm says that you prefer H, and now H is directly connected to D. So our last calculation will be directly H to D is 2. So therefore our full, if we calculate the path from A to B to E to G to H to D, or A to B to E to F to H to D, these are the two alternatives remaining. So out of that we have estimated that smallest one comes out to be A to B 2 plus B to E again 2, 2 plus 2 4, E to F is 2, so 2 plus 2 plus 2, that is 6, F to H is again 2, that is 2 plus 2 plus 2 plus 2, that is 8, and 8 again 8 plus 2, that is H to D is 10. So total distance comes out to be 10, that is A to D, the shortest path possible path is 10. Quickly if you look for the alternatives, just orally we will do the exercise from figure A. Just see, A to B 2 plus B to C 7, 7 plus 2 9, C to D 3. So total becoming 9 plus 3, 12, okay, greater than 10. Second option, A to G to H to D. So A to G 6, 6 plus G to H 4. So 6 plus 4, 10, 10 plus 2, 12, again greater than 10. Our final calculation, 10, we have reached A to B to E to F to H to D. We are checking for alterations. A to B to C to D 12, A to G to H to D 12. See here, A to B to E to G, so 2 plus 2 plus 1, G to H 4, so 4 plus 1 plus 4 9, 9 plus H 2 2 11, so it is becoming 11. If we go for A to B, B to E, E to F, F to C, C to D, then it is becoming 2 plus 2, A to B 2, B to E 2, E to F 2, that is 6, 6 plus C again, F to C 3, that is 9, and C to D, that is 9 plus 3, 12. So if anywhere you check any other option, definitely it will be greater than 10. So therefore our shortest path is directly what we have calculated from the basic method, that is 10 from A to D. So this is the way for each and every node. If we want to calculate, we can do. Many other metrics besides hops and physical distance are also possible. For example, each arc could be labeled with the mean queuing and transmission delay for some standard test packet as determined by hourly test runs. With this graph labeling, the shortest path is the fastest path rather than the path with the fewest arcs or kilometers. So as an example, we have seen this. If delay is used as a metric and the router knows the delay to each of its neighbor, once every t milliseconds, each router sends to each neighbor a list of its estimated delays to each destination. It also receives a similar list from each neighbor.